still, and the waves continue tossing me from the storm. I call his name for relief from things distressing me now. So quietly it comes, strength to find my course again. And though he's done so much for me, the sweetest gift will always be his peace. Peace in the midst of my storms. His answer, peace in the midst of our storms. For when we cry to him for mercy, his sweet love takes the form of peace. In the midst of our storm, what's tomorrow's hold, they hold joy or sadness coming day by day. But let's not be afraid, though we know the storms will come our way. But let the enemy be sure we will not be lost at sea, for there will never come a time that with prayer we will not find his peace. Peace in the midst of our storms. Peace and the peace in the midst of our storms. For mercy, his sweet love takes the form of peace. In the midst of those storms, of our storm, he sent peace, he sends peace, he will send
thank you very much, Stel, for those two beautiful songs. Amen? His eye is on the sparrow. And if his eyes can focus on the sparrow, how about for those of us who are much larger? He won't miss us, right? And as the second song says, he gives us peace. He gives us peace in the worst of our storms. Amen? Thank you. Thank you for those two songs. Those two songs could not have been a better choice in songs for our sermon title this morning and our sermon this morning. I certainly thank Pastor Gittins for asking of me to present God's word this morning. You know, and I have been studying and I have been praying and asking God to give me a message. And I do have some words planned. So this morning I do hope that even though I have some words planned to say, that if it's God's will to change those words while I speak, then let him do so. I also invite you to pray with me that God will speak through me and bring a blessing to us all. Shall we pray? Father in heaven, it's an awesome, sacred responsibility to be able to present your word. For it is your word that is truth. It is your word that is light. So again this morning, Father, I pray and I beseech you that you will hide me behind your cross. And may the words that I speak be words that you want your church and those who are looking and listening online to hear today. Grant us your peace and your blessing. We ask in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Amen. A few years ago, I was enthralled by a series that came on television. The name of the series, and I'm waiting for the season, the next season to come on, was entitled In Plain Sight. And In Plain Sight was a series on television that depicts a program that is designed by the federal government called Witness Protection. The Federal Witness Protection is a program that will pluck an individual or a family from the established residence and environs and put them, or him or her, in a place that nobody can find them. Imagine you having to go to a place for your own protection where nobody knows you, and you have to assume a new name and a new identity. Change from blonde to redhead. From glasses to contact lens. Leave behind your friends and associates, even though sometimes you have to leave some behind. But those for whom you care and with whom you associate, you now leave them and go to a place and establish a brand new identity. And I looked, one of the things that intrigued me about the show is the struggles of children sometimes who sneak away and try to make a phone call to their boyfriend because wherever you're going, nobody ought to know. Witness protection. And this morning, I want us to focus in on a story that is found in the book of Esther, one of the most intriguing and fascinating stories of the Bible. And when you get home, I want you to read the entire book of Esther. After your sumptuous lunch, go read the book of Esther. There are only 10 chapters, and they are not very long chapters. But when you start reading the book of Esther, you will not want to put it down until you come to the end, because the end is intriguing too. Esther establishes that King Xerxes, who we sometimes call Ahasuerus, for his third anniversary as a king, decided to have a party. But not just any ordinary party. The Bible records that he was partying for 180 days. That's 6 months, half of the year. I don't know how many of you could party like that. I go to a party for 2 hours, I get bored. My belly is full, I want to go home. But for 180 days, he was celebrating in party, but not just with regular folk. He was celebrating with the princes and established leaders of Medo-Persia. High-ranking officials. And when the 180th day came, he decided, now let me have a party for the regular folk. And this party is going to last for 7 days. So for 187 days, he was partying. And somewhere towards the end of the seventh day, in the last week of that party, the Bible says, the King James Version says, that his heart was merry. Now, I don't know. I won't ask you. Because I don't know how much you drink or don't drink. The New International Version says that his heart was high with spirits. The New International Translation says that he was half drunk. So between merry, high in spirit, and half drunk, we know that King Xerxes was drunk. And after 187 days, he remembered. The Bible says, Dr. Smith, he remembered Queen Vashti. Now, I don't know about you, but if I'm having a party, my wife has to plan the party. But you see, the king was having his own party, and the Bible says that Vashti was having her own little party on the side for all the girls. You see, when the king was having his party, it was only about the men. I want to think, though, that there were women because they needed dancers and entertainers. And the king remembered Vashti. That's what Esther says. And the king sent a command and said to Esther, put on the crown and the royal garment and come before all these people and model. Come and show off, because the Bible says that she was fair and good to look upon. Just like some of you here, ladies, just beautiful and fair to look upon. The king was half drunk and high in spirits, and now he wanted his wife to model and to show off her curves before all of the princes. And the Bible says that Vashti refused. And the word got to the king immediately. King, she said that she doesn't want to be part of this party that you have because she has her own party going on and the girls are pretty wild over there. And the king, with the few little brain cells that were still alive and sober in his head, was mad. And so he called his eunuch and the prince of the eunuch and all the wise men. And there was one there, an older guy by the name of Memucan, the chief. And the king said, "What shall I do?" And Memucan kind of thought about it, and he wrote a little thesis in the end, and he said, "King, I'm ready to tell you." He said, "King, what this woman has just done is a total embarrassment." And there was no smile on his face. He said, "Not only has she disrespected you, O King, live forever, but think of what is going to be the message that she is sending throughout all of your provinces. What is it going to say about the role of men? How can the men go back home when the king can't control his own girl? How can they go back home and expect that they can control their girls or their women?" See, what Memucan and Xerxes and some men today don't understand, that it has always been the voice of the women. In my home, it is like that. That's why I'm so happy. When my wife says, "Wash the dishes," I wash it. When she says, "Leave the study and come upstairs now," I do. Memucan didn't get that memo. That was an inter-office memo. He missed it. What shall we say? How disrespect, King? You gotta set an example. So, King, the best advice I've got for you, it's written right here, is to get rid of Vashti and get a more subservient and a more willing, a new queen. And the drunk king, the high king, the alcohol addicted king, bowed his head, shook his head, and said, "Stell, sounds like a good plan." And so in walked Hadassah. The opportunity here for Esther. She had two names, Hadassah and Esther. A young girl. Aubrey, she was a virgin, pretty, and young. And if I were to ask this church a question about Esther, what is it that you remember, or what is it that Esther is most famous for? What would you say? Her courage. Oh yes, Esther was remembered and is remembered for her courage, church. But I want to submit a few things to you before we get to the courage part about Esther. I want to let you know that her life was not an easy one. The glamorous queen that we remember her for was not always that kind of a glamour. For you see, she was an orphan. Esther was an orphan who was taken into kinship by her cousin Mordecai. And when Mordecai heard that Vashti was out the door and she had her suitcase packed and was on the curbside, Mordecai started to plot and scheme and plan. And he called up Esther. And he said to Esther, "Girl, here is a chance for you to use your beauty and your charm and to get to be the replacement queen." And she probably smiled. Sounds like a good plan. I want you to really think with me this morning. "But Esther," "Yes, cousin," "when you get to the palace, I want you to hide the fact that you are a Jew. I want you to kind of a lie about who you are. I want you to hide, but in plain sight. I want you to go into witness protection." "What do you mean, uncle?" "You mean I can't sing and welcome Sabbath on Friday evening?" "No. Nobody must know that you welcome Sabbath. How about my tithe? You know, they pay the queen a pretty handsome little thing. I'm supposed to give God 10%. What am I supposed to do with it?" "No. If you return tithe, they will know you're a Jew." Let me put it in context of you today. Sister Daphne, you'd probably ask, "How about my veggie links?" Stell, you too. "How about my veggie mutton? How about my Kung Po veggie chicken?" "No." "So what can I do as a Christian?" "Nothing. You're in witness protection. You gotta hide in plain sight." I don't know about you. You know, September is usually the month in our church, one of the months that we focus on the family. So this today is a family-focused sermon. I don't know how many of you as parents can, Sister Gittens, how many of us would put our daughters through this? Well, what am I talking about? Well, let me tell you this. To be considered for queen, it was not just Esther. It was a whole bunch of young, virgin, pretty girls being brought to the palace. I don't know about you, but I've seen some TV shows with moms, just moms, not the contestants, with moms who want their children to enter beauty pageant, moms of beauty pageants. Those scenes are not pretty sights. Can you imagine? 100 pretty virgins in the palace. That one is thinking she thinks she is pretty. That one is wanting to scratch out this one's eyes. She wants to take out the false hair here. She wants to pluck out the nails. Not a pretty sight. I wouldn't let Averne go into that. You see, let me make it real plain for you, because I think you're not getting the picture that I want you to see Esther in. See, when all the young girls came to the palace of Xerxes, they had to go through a beauty check by the chief selector, Haggai. She was a stern old woman. She would look at you and figure out whether you passed the initial test. And if you passed the test, you had to go through a 1 year of purification. 6 months, oil of myrrh. It's like Glen Ivy. Every single day. Soak you down and scrub you up. And 6 months of oil of myrrh. And then the other 6 months, Sister Forbes, would be for fragrance. Jasmine, Dolce and Gabbana, Tommy Hilfiger. But it's not just you. It's several women vying to become queen. I don't know, but I wouldn't allow Averne to go into that if she wants a man. You see, focus with me. You see, the initiation of Esther to become queen is paramount and is likened to what I refer to as putting your daughter in the Playboy mansion with Hugh Hefner. He touches and feels, and if he likes you, then you become the face, either the center page, I don't know that one, or the cover of the Playboy magazine. That's your coronation. You become queen for a month. Now you would agree with me, Mordecai, come on, church, was not a good parent. You have to admit. I want better for my daughter. First of all, the king is a heathen king. He's a drunkard. He's a womanizer. No, Averne wouldn't go there. She better not. I still have my machete that I brought from Grenada. But listen this. This is what, I don't know what Ken has, but this is what Mordecai put Esther through. You can't sing on Friday night. You can't return your tithes. No, you can't even put on your Sabbath dress. You can't eat vegelings from Loma Linda. You can't even watch 3ABN because they'll know that you're a Christian. 99.1 all the time. MTV. But not TBN or 3ABN. Hiding in plain sight because you have to pretend to be someone that you really are not. But here is a few more things about Esther. You see, for the year that she is in purification, she hasn't had a chance to even see the king yet. But after the purification, all the girls are going through 1 year of purification. But I want you to also know, not all the girls came in at the same time. Girls keep coming in every day. Haggai is passing through another pretty girl. So girls are lining up, and there are several scores and scores. Janabel of young girls starting and ending purification. And when you end the purification, that's when you make an appointment. That's when you got an appointment. Haggai gave you an appointment for you to spend the night with the king for testing purposes. Bad parenting, Mordecai. I don't care what you tell me. I'm not putting my daughter through that. I'm not putting my son through that. There got to be another way. So the Bible says that finally, the day came, the evening came. That's what the Bible says, when it was Esther's turn. And she went in unto the king to spend the night. And when the king looked on her olive skin and her sparkling teeth and her fine pedicure and manicure with her flowing black hair, the Bible says that immediately King Xerxes fell in love and declared, "You are the one." And so, on the morning, before she left his chambers, he took the crown that was once Vashti's crown and placed it on the head of Esther. And she walked out of the king's bedroom all smiles. 1 year of purification, 6 months of scrubbing with cucumber and mud, 6 months of jasmine, lavender, and sweet pea. And now she is walking out the king. But let me also show you something. The Bible says that when King Xerxes crowned Esther was in his 7th year of reign, the king kicked out Vashti during the 3rd anniversary. So Esther lived a life hiding in plain sight for 4 long years. For 4 years, Esther looked at women go in and out of the king's chamberlain. For 4 years, she sat there, got scrubbed, and got cleaned up and waited for her turn. For 4 years, she had to eat pork bellies instead of veggie links. For 4 years, she drank from the queen's goblets instead of Welch's wine. For 4 years, she couldn't return tithe. For 4 years, she couldn't even sing, "Nearer, My God, to Thee," or any of the Sabbath songs. For 4 years, hiding in plain sight. And so Esther started to live the life of the queen. Haggai continued to give girls the pass. And so there were many girls satisfying the king, but there was just one queen. And then one day, Esther got a message that her cousin Mordecai, who was still sitting at the gate, was dressed up in sackcloth and ashes. "What is it? What is going wrong? What is going on, cousin?" He sends a message back to her and says, "There is a decree that's going out. A decree that says that at a certain time, signed by the king, orchestrated by Haman, that all Jews will be killed." "Well, what do you want me to do, cousin? I am the queen." "Forget the fact that he hasn't called me in to perform any queenly function in a few months, but I'm still the queen. I still wear the ring. I still got the crown." I haven't told them that I'm a Seventh-day Adventist yet. I have kept the secret. I missed my veggie links. But I can't let them know that I believe in God. I could probably think it, but they don't know. I haven't returned my tithe and offering in a long time, but nobody knows. And Mordecai sent back a message to her and said, "Cousin Esther, Queen Esther, this decree that has been decreed to kill Jews also is a decree against you. Because even though for the last 4 years and more you have not recognized it, you have grown so accustomed, and that sense of God, that's what I want to tell you this morning. Sometimes we get so accustomed to being who we are, not that we forget who we are. You see, Esther was living a life of a change identity for so long that she forgot that she was Jewish. She had become so accustomed to skimming and hiding and lying that she was totally oblivious to the fact that, yes, that decree does include me. Oh, the false hair and the jasmine and the sweet pea skin. When you take all this away and all the yellow fingernails and the blue fingernails, when you take this away, I'm still a Jew. And then Mordecai, her cousin, reminds her and said, "You know what? Maybe all the lying we've been doing." He didn't probably say it like that. But what the Bible says is that the Bible says, happenstance. Maybe, just maybe, you have come to become queen for this very event. I don't know about you. I won't chance it with Averne to save the world. I won't put my daughter through all this agony of hiding and skimming and lying and make-believing because we want to save San Bernardino. San Bernardino is going down without the help of my daughter. And so Queen Esther was jolted to the realization that she needed to save her life and the life of her people. And so she got up, put on her crown, and dressed in her queenly uniform. And the Bible says that she entered into the courts of the king, violating rules and protocols, violating laws well established for generations, violating her role as queen of subservience. And she entered because she entered with one thing on her mind, with a conviction that says, "I am going to see the king and I'm going to plead my case. And if he does not accept me, I am prepared to die. Because what I will do for this one time in the next 4 years, in the last 4 years, would be the right thing to do. If I perish," her favorite words in Esther, "I perish." So what is the lesson this morning that Esther is teaching us? What is the message that I want to bring out? Here is the message, saints of God. Even in our scheming, even in our calamities, even in our sinfulness, when we cry out to God, God makes a way where there is no way. God finishes a plan where there were no designs. God hears and he answers. Like Samson, stuck in the dungeon with his eyes plucked out and his hair just beginning to grow and his muscles still in atrophy from the scene, when Samson called out to God in his misery, God heard him. And I want to believe that this is the same voice that Esther carried with her when she approached the king. O king, live forever. What is it, Esther? What is it? By now, God had worked on his heart. He forgot protocol. He forgot the role of the queen. All he was seeing in front of him was his beloved wife and king. What is it, Queen Esther? I have heard something, O king. There is a decree that's going out, that has gone out. At a certain date, all of the Jews are going to be killed. Yes, my dear, I signed it myself. What does it have to do with you? Oh, king, live forever. There's a secret that I've been living with. There's something that I've got to come clean with. There's something that I've got to tell you today. And what is it, my beloved? I'm a Jew. I'm a Christian. Oh, I've been working in that office for the last 4 years. Nobody knows that I'm a Christian. Oh, I've been teaching at that school for a little while, but nobody knows that I eat veggie meat. And I don't drink coffee. See, saints of God, it doesn't matter sometimes, because God uses our calamities. And that's part of the secret. When God uses those trying circumstances, his name reverberates and his name is honored and his name is glorified. What is it do you want, Esther? Yes, king, not only are you going to kill every Jew in your province, but that includes me, because my father and forefather is Abraham. I'm a Jew. I'm just like one of them. And king, if you kill Jews, then you would have to kill me too, and I don't care. I don't want any special privileges. I don't want you to favor me for any reason. I don't want you to save my life. I want you to save the lives of all Jews. Because I'm coming clean. And read the story when you get home. The story ends beautifully. The chief architect of the plan to destroy the Jews was hung in a gallows. Mordecai, who spent a greater part of his life opening and closing gates and checking ID, who came to see the king, was promoted. Promoted. And Esther's reign as queen continued. God is waiting to hear you cry from the depths of your misery. From the depths of my misery, God is waiting to hear me cry. From the depths of my sin, from the events of tragedy in my life that has brought me into shame and abject disgrace, God is just waiting for me to cry out. And when I cry out, God is saying, I am here. Esther cried out. God answered, and he was there to save her people. Samson cried out. God was there to take the lives of the enemy. Will you cry out? Cry out to God and say, God, have mercy. And we are going to hear from him. I am here, son. I am here, daughter. And it doesn't matter what situation you are in. When I tell you, I am here. I am here.